Thank you for staying with us. Now, on Urban Business, well, people will always need banking and other financial services, and how they access these services is always what the issue shall be, and it has changed dramatically with the advent of technology. Urban Magazine spoke to a lot of people in the financial area as experts, and they gave us key takeaways from the digital transformation trends that the banking sector has embraced in this era. Let's look at this.
Before coronavirus, the 2020s were already being framed as the decade for digital bank transformation. Such changes reflected a mounting hunger for must-have innovations, including seamless, hyper-personalized user experiences. This shift also reflected a practical need for more efficient operations, as well as increasing pressures for banks to boost their return on equities and decrease cost-income ratios. Uganda Bankers Association is in agreement with such developments, and this is why.
Cash is not favorable. That digital is favorable. The second thing is that with the new digital capabilities, there's a lot much more you can do. So you'll have seen from the presentations the increase in the number of transactions done on mobile and the value in the trillions of shillings that has grown over the period. We also put in place a number of initiatives during the time that we went into that COVID-induced lockdown for the country to promote the utilization of digital. Banks and financial institutions have been investing heavily over time in digital capability. And the benefit of that is becoming much more real now as there's increased sensitization of the public about the value of utilization of digital out of convenience, etc. So the financial literacy that has happened in the past has been augmented now by the accelerated need to transition into digital. By the COVID pandemic. And that's not perhaps happening only in Uganda, that's happening across the globe.
And we are going to face a significant erosion of financial inclusion gains. The focus of the means, which is fintech, which is payments, which is credit, should be towards the end, which is deepening financial services for people to increase their take-home income, for businesses to survive beyond their third birthday. So the idea should be, how do we leverage technology? How do we make sure financial services can be delivered at one-tenth of the value? How do we de-risk non-collateralized credit? How do we look at mortgage financing so that people have long-term assets and don't go back into old age poverty?
But for starters, what is digitalization? Well, this is conversion of data into a digital format with the adoption of technology. By embracing digitalization, banks can provide enhanced customer services. This provides convenience to customers and helps in saving time.
Proposals for creating interoperability and combined utilization, a governance framework for a switching system and a payment system where many players will be working together. Examples from what they've picked in places like Ghana and Malawi. But also, as an industry, we are working towards shared infrastructure, which should be able to reduce the cost of duplication, which is embedded in the pricing today, because every institution has its own capability and has invested individually. So shared infrastructure is one way that we'll be able to bring down the cost of digital financial services.
We had an estimate that if I had to construct a physical data center, I would pay at least close to 50 to 60% more if it was physical, as opposed to hosting that in the cloud system. And that was an estimate that we arrived at a UBL level. So it is a significant cost that we really, really have to look into. And there are other ways to achieve what the regulator is trying to achieve. A regulator, and rightly so, would like to be able to view what's going on, to audit what's going on in each data system, make sure it's okay and it's up to standard. Like the deputy governor pointed out, security, information security, and having a standard across the industry is going to be important. So we hear our regulator and we are in line, and we are saying there's a cheaper way to achieve the same objective.
Some of the products that have so far been introduced include the use of a Visa debit card InterSwitch, which allows banks to share a network with the customer from Bank A withdrawing from Bank B.
The Bank of Uganda has requested all the commercial banks to enhance their cybersecurity firewalls to ensure that we try to, a large extent, minimize all the cybersecurity frauds that go around. And of course, as we move into more e-payment system, the cybersecurity crooks are also going to be coming on board. All these frauds are going to be coming, so we need to also run parallel efforts to strengthen, the cybersecurity issue. This is one of the issues that is going to be discussed in this strategy for the national payment system going forward.
And with COVID-19 and its restrictions of social distancing still evident, Bank of Uganda too is pushing for the same target. This gives the banking industry a new look.
The idea of branch optimization for many institutions is really leveraging a combination of channels. Entities will have different channels, but in the advent of COVID, we'll have found better ways of mixing and matching the access to those various channels. So I think that where you see bank branch sort of coming out, you will see much more digital capability coming forward. And you see, so for instance, in the advent of agent banking, mobile banking, etc., most of the payments related work that has been done out of branch outlets can now be done digitally. And increasingly, you will see that happening also on the credit side, etc.
However, the regulator is still concerned with the varying charges at ATMs charged by different banks. For instance, some banks charge 7,000 shillings, others 6,500, while others don't charge at all. This still means that banks are operating individually yet regulated jointly. So, does this explain why some banks have more clients than others? Well, maybe not. It could explain why recently most banks are closing branches.
In supporting businesses through the hard times in the economy occasioned by COVID-19, sometimes is not brought out clearly. But if you look, for example, in our own country, the way we've restructured facilities for different customers to allow them moratoriums not to be paying in this period has enabled liquidity to remain in those businesses to sustain the businesses through this period. Now, as coming out of the moratoriums, I think different banks will have to work very closely with customers from a relationship management point of view to see how to support them through the end of those moratoriums and coming back into repayment. And different customers have been given different periods, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months. So there will be distress because of reduced consumption due to a fall in aggregate demand across the economy, plus other structural challenges during this period. But I think that eventually the economy will be revived. You also know that many of our businesses are small businesses, and the resilience of small businesses to come out of hard times has been tested in Uganda in the past.
High costs of transactions have for a while been blamed for the increased reluctance among the public to embrace digital transactions. Bank of Uganda, through the National Payment Systems Policy, is seeking to at least have achieved a cashless economy by 2021.
Well, that's all we had time for on the Urban Magazine tonight. It's been amazing having your company. We look forward to you joining us again on Friday at 9:30 p.m. here on Urban TV. My name is Barbara Nyamwiza. Blessed night.